Hi, I'm Jeff Hurst. I'm an undergraduate working for Dalton Research Group at University of Washington, and this is a Teng-Man in situ polling device. Teng-Man is an elipsometric technique to measure the electro-optic coefficient known as R33. Polling is a process to induce order in host polymer chromophore materials, and in situ means that we can monitor electric, optic, and thermal data all in real time. Next, I'll go over the device setup. The optical setup begins with a 1310 nanometer laser, which passes through a polarizer into a compensator and then is focused onto the sample on the sample stage. From the sample stage, the beam is reflected to a cross polarizer and then into a photodiode. So next, I'll discuss the electrical setup. We use a preamp and a lock-in amplifier to amplify the AC electrical signal coming from the photodiode. We use a picometer to measure current across the sample, and we use a high voltage sourcer to pull the sample. This is the sample that we characterize. It is an ITO glass slide that has been spun coated with a host polymer chromophore system, which is the material of interest, and then sputter coated with gold electrodes. We've then attached two wires, one end to the ITO side and one end to the gold electrode side. Next, we will affix a sample to the stage to begin polling and to measure the electro-optic coefficient. To do this, we slide the sample into the stage and then tighten it to the stage with this screw. Once the sample is relatively tight, we want to align the beam so that the light passes directly through the gold electrode at the top here. To do this, we use this two-photon card, which will allow us to see the infrared beam. Once the sample is aligned, we will attach the wires to the electrical posts inside the box. Next, we will place the lid on the box. This is an important step as it keeps light out and will also create a semi-airtight environment into which we can pump nitrogen gas. The first step is to input the information for the sample into this box here, where it is stored on the computer as an electronic lab notebook. We input the username, the material, the concentration of chromophore in that particular polymer, the name of the chromophore, the sample number, and the thickness, which we've determined using a profilometer previously. After the information is entered, we can click the run button, which is a forward pointing arrow up here in the left hand corner, and this will begin the polling process. Now the instrument is running, and we can see here a graph on the bottom with three separate traces. This is optical data coming from the infrared laser that is incident on the sample at 45 degrees. This optical data is the intensity gradient derived from a phase shift related to birefringence induced by Pockel's effect. What we want to do is maximize the signal by adjusting the compensator. These buttons here activate a motion controller, which rotates the compensator so that we can find the best position in order to obtain signal. First, I will click the zero button to begin moving the compensator. We can see the signal into the photodiode changing now as the compensator is rotated. So we want to adjust the compensator to achieve the maximum isobem value, which is shown as this white trace here. I have adjusted the compensator, shown by the red trace here, until I've achieved the highest isobem value. It's important to keep in mind also that we do not want the compensator value labeled by this red trace here and labeled as I sub C to pass greater than 1 volt. At greater than 1 volt, the lock-in amplifier is overloaded. Okay. Once we have optimized the signal by adjusting the compensator, we click this button here labeled start pulling. Once this button is clicked, the solenoid will flip to begin filling the chamber with nitrogen gas. At this point, we will want to turn on the temperature controller by flipping this switch and setting it to the appropriate power setting for our stage. Then we want to select the strength of our DC pulling field by inputting the value into this white box here labeled set point and VRMS per micron. In this case, we will select a pulling field of 75 volts per micron of thickness on the sample film. Once that value is entered, the high voltage sourcer will begin ramping to the desired voltage. We can adjust this ramp rate here in the box just below the set point labeled ramp rate, and this is in volts per minute. Generally, we leave this at 60. If we decide to ramp faster, we may double or triple it. We'll also want to set the desired temperature for the material. We want to ramp the temperature linearly to the TG point for that particular polymer that we're using. And we do this by inputting the set point into this box here, labeled set point 2. In this case, I'm going to select 107 degrees Celsius. Once the desired set point voltage and temperature are set, the program will begin ramping up the voltage and the temperature to induce pulling. On this upper graph here, shown is the temperature, shown as this green line, and the pulling voltage, shown as this red line. The blue line, just above the red line, is the current that is being passed across the sample. The lower graph here is the optical data being received from the photodiode. At low temperatures, the signal off the sample is low, so this graph will look mostly as noise. As the temperature increases, signal from the sample will increase and trends in the optical data will become more clear. Now that the set point temperature has been reached, we can look at the optical data graph on the bottom, where the red line represents what we call I sub C, which is total light incident on the photodetector. The white line corresponds to the refractive index changing as we induce order, and it's labeled I sub M. And the green trace is a ratio of I sub M over I sub C. It is important during the pulling process to monitor the phase offset, which is taken from the lock-in amplifier. In this case, we can see a phase offset changing, but as high as 17 degrees. In this case, we'll want to push the phase lock button, which will then command the lock-in amplifier to lock in on the AC signal coming from the photodiode. This is a saved optical trace from a previous run. On this trace, the I sub C, or total light incident on the photodiode, is now a red line here. The I sub M, which is the change in refractive index, is now represented by a black line. And the ratio of the two lines is represented by a green line. On this trace, we can see that as temperature increased and we approached the TG temperature of the polymer, we began to induce order, which is represented by the climb in both the ratio and the I sub M trace. Then, as the temperature was cooled, the I sub M and also ratio remained relatively constant here and at a higher value than they began at. From this increase in I sub M, we can deduce that there was pulling that took place inside this material. Once the sample has cooled sufficiently, the DC voltage is removed from the sample, and the computer will then begin measuring the R33 by rotating the compensator. This can also be performed at any point by clicking the Measure EO button. So now I'll click the Measure EO button to begin measuring the R33. The machine is now zeroing the compensator, and it is rotating it, which is shown by the change in the total light incident on the photodiode, which is the red line. So once the compensator has completed a full rotation, the program will then use its fitting routines to calculate an R33, which is reported in this box. And the maximum temperature reached during pulling process is also reported just above the R33. This particular sample did not effectively pull. Consequently, it reports a very low R33 of 0.3 picometers per volt. This is also demonstrated by the small amplitude of the I-sub-M fit, which is the yellow line in the lower graph. An appreciable value for R33 would be somewhere near 150 picometers per volt. It is important to monitor both the electrical and optical signal during pulling so that we can more accurately determine the appropriate set point temperature, or TG temperature, for the sample we are using. By doing this, we can more efficiently and more reliably pull. After pulling is complete, the computer will rotate the compensator and measure the R33. We do not, however, use this reported R33 as a firm value, as there is an inherent error in this measurement that is very high. Instead, we use it to confirm whether pulling did occur or in fact did not occur. In this case, pulling did not occur, as we reported a very, very low R33, and our optical data during pulling did not show a substantial climb in I sub M, which would indicate pulling.